like to invite your attention to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. And we'll begin reading at verse 12. Very familiar passage of scripture. We've taught on it before, but it bears repeating. There's only 66 books in the Bible, so at some point we'll recycle something. We'll go back over something. And I know for me that in my study of the scripture, I can read something over and over, and it seems like every time I read it, I get a little something else out of it. 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and at verse 7, the word of God says, "Lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." The Apostle Paul is the writer of this particular letter here. And it is interesting that he's talking about prayer here. A prayer that is seemingly unanswered. And of course, we are taught down through the years, we've been taught that God answers prayer.
Yes. Thank you.
God is a, you know, prayer answering God. We sing songs about prayer. You know, Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you want. Just call him up and tell him what you want. And I think that we have somehow become somewhat disenchanted or misunderstanding of what prayer actually is. Prayer is not necessarily or per se that you just bow your head or get on your knees and give God a laundry list of things. It's not necessary that you tell God to fix this or heal that or do this or that and the other. But prayer is communion between you and God. Prayer is designed to get you to accept God's will for your life. So we see that Paul here, the Bible says that he has prayed about a particular thing 3 different times. And sometimes, you know, people can think that because you are in a bind, or if you are going through a trial or going through a struggle, that you must have done something to deserve it. You know, that there must be some sin in your life as to why God is not answering your prayer. But may I tell you that sometimes God's will is not what you want. Sometimes God's will is just not what you want. You may have all of these grandiose ideas and all of these plans, but that may not be what God has in mind for you. So Paul says here, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelations. And we know it wasn't that the Paul's prayer is not being answered here because Paul wasn't saved. We know it wasn't because Paul wasn't living right. I mean, we're talking about an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you remember back over in the 16th chapter of the book of Acts, Paul, if anybody knew how to get a prayer through, Paul did. Because in the 16th chapter of the book of Acts, Paul and Silas were in prison. You know that story. That's when Paul cast the devil out of the woman of divination, and they beat Paul and Silas and threw them in prison. And the Bible says at midnight, Paul and Silas begin to pray and sing songs. So it wasn't that Paul wasn't a righteous man. So be careful when folks are going through, you know, automatically assuming that they did something to deserve where they are. They did something, it's something they didn't do that caused them to draw the lot that they have. That's not necessarily the case always. So he said, unless I be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelation that was given to me. It was given to Paul. And man, I hate to tell you, sometimes there's going to be some stuff given to you. You didn't ask for it. You didn't deserve it. It was just given to you. And so now he says, unless I be exalted through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh. Some stuff is just given to you. You just gonna have to deal with it. You know, we've been taught down through the years that if you go looking for trouble, you won't find it. And that's true. If you look for trouble, you'll find it. But all the time, you don't go looking for it. Sometimes trouble will find you. Sometimes trouble will knock at your door. It just comes to you. So he says, lest I be exalted through the abundance of the revelation, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. God is sovereign, and God is omnipotent or all-knowing. He knows what's best for you. Nobody likes trouble. Nobody likes trials. So automatically when trouble comes or when a trial comes, we pray about this thing. Nothing wrong with that. Can I submit to you that God has always answered every single prayer that you've ever prayed? You know, you hear people saying, thank God for unanswered prayer. There is no such thing as an unanswered prayer. Sometimes the answer is no. No is an answer. You don't need that. You might think you need it, but God knows what's best for you. He knows the ending of a thing from the beginning. He knows that if I give you that, that's going to take you out of my will, so you don't need. So at verse 8, the Bible says, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice. I prayed about this thing three different times. Watch this. That it might depart from me. I prayed on three different occasions that it might depart from me. Now again, if anybody knows how to get in touch with God, if anybody knows how to get a prayer through, we're talking about Paul does. Yes. This is an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul laid hands on people and God healed them. Paul prayed and God raised the dead. Paul was in prison. He and Silas were in prison, and they began to pray, and God sent an earthquake to shake the prison to set Paul free. If anybody could get a prayer through, Paul could.
Amen. Hallelujah.
So it's not that you know, some folk, because we become creatures of habit.
Yes.
Pray a certain, you know, we would pray, and then sometime God will move right then.
Amen.
And all we can rejoice about that, all God is a, God answers prayer. But I just told you, he always answers prayer.
Yes.
He's been answering prayer. He just said no. So in verse 8, he said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice. I prayed about this thing on three different occasions. Where did we've seen this in scripture before, that somebody prayed about something on three different times. It was Jesus Christ, Son of the Most High God, that prayed in the Garden of Gethsemane on three different times, that the cup of the crucifixion would pass from him. And God said, no. And it was Jesus that finally said, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Not my will, but thy will be done. But see, when we pray, we may as well say, not thy will, but my will be done. That's basically what we, because we get out on our knees or we bow our heads and we, Lord, do this. Lord, do that. Right now, Lord. Right now, Lord. Never asking or considering, Lord, what is your will? Because sometimes, unfortunately, God's will is not what you want.
Amen.
God's will is not what you want. It's not always what you want.
Amen.
And when Jesus was teaching the disciples to pray, over in the 6th chapter of Matthew, we've looked at this several times, but he opened the prayer and he told them to say, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. That was the model prayer that he's teaching us how to pray. He's telling us to pray that thy will be done. Question today is, can you handle the will of God? Sometimes the will of God will be painful. Sometimes the will of God will be that you lose friends. Sometimes the will of God is to take you out of situation. It may be that take you out of your comfort zone.
Yes.
But it's the will of God. How can you tell when it's the will of God? When you have done absolutely nothing to cause the situation that you're in.
Amen.
It's nothing that you did. It's nothing that you didn't do. That, my friend, is the will of God.
Yes.
You can pray about it. You can cry about it, but sometimes, look at verse 9 now. Okay, verse 8, he said, for this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. At verse 9, now watch this, look at verse 9, he said, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. In other words, Paul, I got you exactly where I want you. I'm not going to move this thing. I'm not going to take it away. But while you're in it, I got you. My grace is sufficient for thee. Grace is sufficient for thee. So my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. My strength is made perfect in weakness. In And all of us can look back over our lives. And there are some things that we dealt with we didn't know we could deal with. There was some strength in us that we didn't know that we had. But we wouldn't know that if we weren't ever put in the predicament to find that out. We wouldn't know that. My grace is sufficient for thee. So isn't it amazing that it was Paul that said, my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory. See, we've got this thing jacked up. Folks will tell you that if you pray and in the name of Jesus Christ, God will do just whatever you ask. If you send me an offering, I'm going to agree with you, and God going to just do whatever you... Sometimes my grace. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you just going to have to walk in grace. Mm-hmm. And it's not going to all... You know, we sang about amazing grace, but all the time it's not going to be amazing grace. He said it's just going to be just enough. So when it's sufficient, it's just enough. Some folk here, folk living with stuff in their body. Doctors are baffled. They're puzzled. You should have been dead. But my grace is sufficient for thee. How did you make it? I don't understand how you made it. I don't know either. But it was the grace of God that was sufficient for thee. See, that's some stuff that happened in your life. Other folk would have lost their ever-loving mind. They would have started smoking. They would have started drinking. But God's grace kept you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Stop complaining about stuff. And understand that God's grace is sufficient for thee. You have... You're getting you whatever you need if it's being taken care of. See, we want to be comfortable. But when you look at different characters of the Bible, some of the most anointed people in the Bible had some of the greatest struggles. I mean, God told Elijah to go out into the wilderness by a brook. And he said, a raven gonna feed you. The Bible said, in the morning a raven came and brought him meat. And in the evening he came and brought him meat and he drank from the brook. God's grace was sufficient. Well, that was all right. But then the brook dried up. God told him to go on into Zarephath. I have commanded a widow there. I'm paraphrasing. I commanded a widow there to sustain you. Well, Elijah gets into Zarephath and finds the widow. And the widow don't have enough. Naturally speaking, she doesn't have enough to sustain the man of God and her son. She don't have enough, but God's grace. God's grace. You know you can look back in your life and you know you didn't have enough, but somehow you made it through. That was the grace of God. That was the grace of God.
Thank you.
So he says, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. All the Lord wants you to do is to do all that you can. when I've done the best I can. Now I've exhausted everything I can do. Now, Lord, it's up to you.
Yes, Lord.
It's up to you. If things never happened to you, you wouldn't have, some of y'all wouldn't have no prayer life. Only time you go to God is when your back is up against the wall and your feet are to the fire. My grace is sufficient for thee. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Well, look at Paul here. Now, the interesting thing about this is, drop back to chapter 11, still in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, because, sometimes we think that, and I've kind of shared with you how anointed Paul was. He is a man that raised the dead. God raised the dead through his prayer. He is a man that was in prison and called on God, and God sent an earthquake to release him from prison. But look at 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and at verse number 22. 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and at verse 22. And the word of God says, are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So I am. Are they seeds of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in death often. Of the Jews 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a day and a night I was in the deep. Now, it wasn't that Paul hadn't already been through anything. I wanted to just show you that it wasn't that Paul hadn't already been through anything. Look at all he's been through. And now he's got a thorn in the flesh. I think about this thing. He's got a thorn in the flesh. And he's prayed. All of this stuff I've already been through. And this thorn, Bible doesn't say what it is, what it was. Lord, look. Lord, you brought, I've been shipwrecked. Stuck out at sea for a night. Lord brought me out of this. I've gone through beatings. Was stoned, and the Lord brought him out. He was stoned. He said, shipwreck, a night and a day have I been in the deep. I was stranded out at sea for a night and a day, and the Lord brought him out. He used to the Lord delivering him. You're used to the Lord answering your prayers.
Thank you, Jesus.
You think because, all of us remember great victories and we know what we prayed when we got there. So if I pray this prayer, if I say what I said the last time, look, verse 26, he said, in journeys often, in peril of waters, in peril of robbers, in peril of my own countrymen, in peril of by the heathens, in peril in cities, in peril in wilderness, in peril in the sea, in peril among false brethren, in weariness, in painfulness, in watching often, in hunger and thirst, in fasting often, in cold and nakedness, besides these things that are without, that which cometh upon me, the daily cares of the church, and God always brought him out. But this time, The answer is no. But this time the answer is no. Look, look, now, verse 9, back over in 12th chapter now, back over in the 12th chapter, at verse 9, and the word of God says, and he said unto me, my grace. He said, in other words, Paul, you're going to have to deal with this. Now think of it. Paul had been, all of this we just read that he was delivered from. All of this that he brought him out. But this thing, you're going to have to deal with it. You're going to have to deal with it, but I'm going to help you deal with it because I'm going to give you the grace to deal with it. I'm going to give you the grace to deal with it. For my grace is sufficient for thee. For my strength is made perfect in weakness. When I've exhausted all of my strength and I lean totally on the Lord, that's when I am perfected. Paul's attitude doesn't change. He doesn't start tripping. He doesn't start crying. He doesn't start cussing. Look at what he said. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Because I know I'm making it by the power of God. I've done the best thing I can. I've done the best I can. I prayed, but I'm still here. It's not gone, but I'm still here. I don't have it. I don't have what I want, but I'm still here. I'm still here. Folks are laughing at me. They're talking about me. But I'm still here. And I'm here by the grace of God. It's by the grace of God. Nothing that I did. Because if I had my druthers, I wouldn't be in this situation. If I had my druthers, I'd have millions in the bank. I think about that old song and I'm closing. It said, I have some good days. He said, I have some weary days and some sleepless nights. I've had some hills to climb. But when I look things over, you know for yourself, all of your good days outweigh your bad days. So stop complaining. Because God's grace is sufficient for thee. Amen. We'll leave it right there. We thank God for you. We thank God for all things in the name of the Lord Jesus. I hope I said something to help somebody. Praise the Lord.
Amen.